Welcome back. So we're going to start the review for the second midterm, which will include chapter 4, 5, and 6. Okay. So here the whole idea about chapter 4, I'm going to say finding X and Y values. It's the whole idea. Well, geometrically, what that really means is finding the interception, or maybe the better word will be intersection of two equations, or I should say lines. Okay, so what I'm trying to explain here is, here's in one equation, straight line, here's another equation, and given these two equations, our job is to figure out the meeting point, which is known as coordinate. Okay, that's what chapter 4 is all about, really. Okay, algebraically, we'd be able to figure it out. Systematically, there are two techniques that chapter 4 explained. Of course, geometrically, we could always graph equations and then be able to pinpoint at where they meet. Okay, so I'm going to show you something is called addition method. Okay, so this is the first technique that we're going to study. So let me rewrite the problem here. Now, so the question here is, okay, how do we solve this one algebraically? So the first step here is, I'm gonna write down the steps. So number one, find the LCM, least common multiple. Okay, of coefficient. Okay. So what that means is you got to choose either X's or Y's and find their LCM, least common multiple. So let's just start out with, 2X and 6X. And of course, to find the LCM, we're going to use this simple technique. 2 next multiple will be 4, next multiple will be 6, 8, you get that idea, 6, 12, and that's kind of useless because we already got it. So in this case, obviously, 6 is the multiple. Now, that means I have to multiply 3 to 2. But when I do that, I got to do it to everyone. So here, new, obviously, equations will be 6x, 15y, 16. Why? Because I need to not only multiply to 2x, but 5 and 8. Well, nothing changes here, so you're going to rewrite. Now, next thing here we have to do is to eliminate this 6x and 6x by, in this case, subtracting. Okay. that when I put subtraction in front of that whole entire equation, make sure everyone changes their sign. So this is gone. 14y, 6, y equals to 6 over 14, which is 3 over 7. Okay, from this point to get the, so we already got the y value. So then how do we obtain the x value? Well, to get the, to find x, we're going to use one of these equations. Well, it doesn't matter which one. I'm just going to use that, the second one. And obviously, I am going to substitute. Okay, so therefore, and you just have to solve for x. Well, since everyone has, well, you know, you're going to swing this to like this. I think 63 over 7, of course, divided by 6. Okay, and I'm sure you know how to reduce this one. Okay, maybe we'll do it with 3. So if I use 3, I'd be able to reduce to 1. Oh, I could do it with 7. So the answer will be 3 over 2. Okay, so that's the answer. So the final answer here will be, you could say 3, 2, 3, 7. That's the point where they run into each other. Okay? All right. So let's try. Let me show you number 2. In this case, again, well, it doesn't matter which one you choose as long as you find their LCM. So I'm going to start out with this guy. Okay, no particular reason, just chose that one. So that means 15 is the LCM, must be 15. I was, you know. So here, obviously, 3 has to be applied. And of course, 5 has to be applied. Okay. So this is gone by adding. In this case, we don't have to subtract. Well, because one of them has negative sign. What happened to them previous problem? Well, as you could see, we have to use negative outside in order to have negative here to be eliminated. Okay? Because they both have positive. So same sign here, we have to use subtraction where we have to change everyone's sign here. But if they have different signs from the very beginning, as you can see from the problem, then we got no problem. Okay. Here will be 19y. I think it might be 9. I could be wrong. Okay. Yeah, 9. Okay. Once I have 9, obviously the next step is very simple. We just have to use this. I'm going to choose maybe the first one this time, 5x minus 2y. Okay. And I'm going to put it right there. And solve for x. Oh, I got 9. So those are the answers. Okay. That's not that bad. Well, in this case, another popular technique besides addition method, we have something is called substitution. So we have these two techniques to solve equations. Literally, substitution means instead of x, because we know x is 2 over 3y, put right in there. So the new setup here is this. And you just have to take care of this one. We're going to multiply everyone by 3. Maybe we don't have to do it this way, you know. Negative y equals negative 12, y equals to 12. Right? Once you have this, obviously to get x, all we have to do is choose one. It doesn't matter, I'll choose the second one. And put right back in there. So x has got to be equal to 8. Okay, so I have 8 and 12. For the answer. Okay, let's move to chapter 5. I think I got mixed up here. Okay. So chapter 5 is the operation with exponentials. I think most of you guys know this, but let me quickly give you brief idea of what exponential operation is, and then we're gonna do the problems. Now there are shortcuts that we all know, which is the here I'm going to say operations of exponent. And the idea here is if we have to multiply variable and happens to be the same variable, and then we end up adding the exponent. Now the reason underneath is this. We know x squared really means xx, x cubed really means xxx. So at the end, we're multiplying x's 5 times. This is all about rule number 1, called power rule, okay? This is called power. Okay. Now, suppose we have this. That means we could subtract these two. Well, what do you mean subtract? Well, that means like this. So we end up having this. Now, any negative exponent means you got to flip. So therefore, like that. In other words, this one goes to the denominator because of the negative exponent. Okay? Let me give you another example. x4y3 x2y. If I want to operate this one, well, I'm gonna, you know, try to operate this by subtracting, and if there's no exponent, that means, you know, there's a 1. So this really means x squared, this really means x to the third. Now in this case, because there's no negative exponent, after the operations here, you don't have to bring downstairs, as you could see. Leave the way it is because everyone's positive, okay? And there are more to it. Let me just go over one more. X4, X, Y to the negative third power. Well, as you could see that, well, when there is a exponent outside of the parentheses, that means not only X is gonna get negative 4, but Y is gonna get negative 4. So it will be negative 3, negative 3. So there we got, like that. Well, they both have negative exponents, so it will be like that. So that will be the end. Okay, so that's the quick summary of chapter 5 about operations of exponents. So we here we got, we're first going to do, oh, by the way, when we encounter, obviously you have to follow something is called order of operations, okay? So keep that in mind, the order. Well, how come I'm doing the exponent before I reduce these two? Well, because of the order of operations. So you know that we have to do parentheses, exponent, and multiplication, division, and addition and subtraction. So therefore, we got to do the exponent. Now here, as you could see, that 2 exponent only applies to y to the third power because x to the fifth power is outside of the parentheses. And then, as you could see, we're going to operate, which is, and that's the answer. Luckily, they both are positive exponents, so we don't have to do anything, okay?
All right.
Next. Oh, this is relatively simple. This is all we have to do. Watch this, though. When there's nothing, we know we put 1 minus minus 9. So as you could see, this minus comes from the operation. That minus 9 comes from the exponent, right? So that will lead us to, you know, negative negative turns out to be positive. Okay, that's not the end. We always like to put it in positive exponents. So you know this has to be heading downstairs. By doing so, as you could see, that negative will disappear. That's just the way we do. Okay. All right, lastly, number 6, well, on this page, of course. I'm going to do one step at a time. That will be negative 10. Let's take care of that one, negative 4, over. And obviously, from this point, you could do these two first. And of course, that one. Of course, that one. Is this. And this one. Okay, so as you could see, after I apply the exponent into the parentheses, and then I took care of the numerators first, now we're going to do it with denominator. So in other words, this is going to be like this. So they both have negative. Okay, that's the final answer. Okay. This is easy, meaning you just have to, you know, put it in. In other words, when x is negative 1/2, what will be the y value, which is known as f of negative 1/2, right? This is all they're saying. So the setup here will be, I will first create the parentheses for x's. And then inside, you're going to put 1/2, and you operate it. Is, oh, at the end we get 5. Okay, so of course you got to know how to operate. Okay, and of course happens to be the same denominator, so you just have to add the numerator. Okay, 8 is again relatively simple. You first have to expand the parentheses, but here you have to be careful. Every time when there's a negative in front of the parentheses, make sure when you open up that parenthesis, make sure everyone half has to change their signs. So this is 1/6. And then from this point, I'm going to group by their kinds, known as like terms. Okay, so 2 over 3 minus 1/15. X squared. Okay. And I'm going to find the common denominator, 5. So it will be 9 over 15 X squared. I know I could reduce this one, but I'm going to wait. Okay. Second one. Of course, when I do this, this will be negative 8 over 12 x. Okay, again, I'm going to reduce it. And last, and of course, the common denominator in this case will be maybe 24 is 4. So this will be 24. 15, 4, 19. So at the end, oops, okay. So at the end, we got, when I reduce this one, that will be 3. Oops, 2 over, it's just the way it is. So you really have to learn how to add or subtract or multiply, divide fractions, okay? Other than that, it's pretty much like terms idea. Simple, straightforward. Okay, number 9, okay? Okay? So that wasn't that bad. Okay, make sure you multiply not only the numbers to numbers, but variable to variables. Number 10. I think the common technique here will be rewrite the parentheses twice. And you know, at the end you're going to get this. Okay? I'm sure you guys all know how to do FOIL thinging, right? Which is, I don't know if I'll just write it out. Minus 8x. Okay, so that's that. 11 is just another practice. Again, when there's a negative, be sure everyone inside of the parentheses change their signs. And of course, you do this. Okay, and that. Now factoring is the next one, which is another prereq for this course. It takes about good 2-3 hours just to teach factoring ideas. So if you are not sure, I strongly suggest that you go to ALC, or I think there's online tutoring available in Canvas. Okay, so go ahead and visit those. What I will do here is I will just do show you how to do, hopefully you'll pick up. Now the first technique, factoring, is known as common factoring. Okay, so how do we do it? Well, we're gonna break it down. So here, 5x x and y, 5 times 3, x, 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 y, y. So as you can see, I break down each term, as you can see. And then what I will do, I will pick out same amount of. So I pull out 5, I pull out x, 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 which is x to the third power, I pull out y. Okay, wait a minute, how come we're not writing twice? Well, that's just the way we do when you factor. Okay, I know we have two of xxx, xxx, but we're only going to write xxx, which is x to the third power. Same thing. I know we pull out 5 and 5, but we'll basically throw out one. We're only going to keep the other. Okay, same thing as y. Now, from this point, inside of the parentheses, we're only going to put leftover. Now, I know the leftover here will be 3xy, very clear, right? However, here everything is gone. Everything is being pulled out. Then we're going to put 1. That technique is known as what? Common factoring. Okay, so when do we apply common factoring? I will say every problem, so such as number 2. Soon as it says to factor, I'm going to apply the common factoring. Okay. Okay. So as you could see that 24x squared minus 15x, when you break it down, I have these two. So I'm going to pull out 3x. And remaining, left over, and dot. Okay. Let's do number 3. Same thing, common factoring. Okay. And then we're going to spot. Now, as you can see, you notice that here we have 3 terms. In our previous 2 problems, there are only 2. Now, the rule remains the same. Meaning, when you pull out 3 and 3 here, you better pull out 3 again. So all 3 terms got to have common items or numbers. 3, 3, 3. How many x's can we pull out? At most, x. So the remaining here is x3, 3x, 2. And that's the answer. Okay, we're going to skip number 4 and 5, okay? Okay, let's do number 6. We're going to do something is called common factoring. 6 is being pulled out. Now, from common factoring, there's another technique is called trinomial factoring. I think the one popular one is known as AC method, but I don't really use AC method. What I will do is, I don't know if they teach you this. You're going to factor negative 12. You're going to factor x squared, but you write them vertically. And the sum of the cross products, so here will be 3x. Here will be negative 4x. Happens to be the middle term that we know the answer, which is okay. So this technique is trinomial factoring, which is not the same way. It's not the same as the AC method. Okay. Number 7, I'm going to do the common factoring. And I'm going to apply the trinomial now. Now, when do we apply trinomial? Well, we apply trinomial, first of all, we have to have three terms. And the leading term must be what? Square. Not cube, not 4. But a square. So here, write down vertically, 9 will be 10 and 1. But one of them has to be negative, because negative 10 times 1 will be negative 10. Now, when you cross multiply, this will give me negative 9x, the sum. So the final answer here will be, and that's the final answer, okay? We're going to skip number 8 and 9. You cannot factor. It's been already factored. It's misprint. Okay? So I'm going to first of all show you number 3. Okay, so here the problem is, how do we solve this equation? Well, obviously you have to first of all understand that this isn't something like chapter 2 where we just solve for x, right? No, this is not exactly the same because of what? Square. So how do we solve this one? Well, we're going to, in this case, use factoring. Okay. So I'm going to first of all factor this, which is trinomial factoring. I'm going to use 2 and 3 will give me 5x. So x plus 2, x plus 3 equals to 0. Now, from this point, each parenthesis, you're going to set it to 0. And then solve for x. So the one of the answer will be negative 3x plus 2. Set it to 0. That will be negative 2. Okay? So those are the two answers. Logic underneath this technique is because if we claim that this one happens to be 0, then immediately the whole thing will turn out to be 0, because 0 times anything will be 0. So in order to be 0 here, well, we have to have negative 2. When I put negative 2, it will be 2. That's the reason why we set x plus 2 equals to 0. Same thing. Negative 3 is the one that's going to turn out to be 0. 0 times anything will be 0. So therefore, it will be negative 3. Okay? So that's that. Number 3. Okay. So let's do, I'm going to show you number 6 first, and then okay, So I'm going to show you number 6. Now, in order to do this one, what we need to do is we have to make one side equal to 0. In other words, negative 5 has to be on the other side. So therefore, we're going to swing negative 5y to the other side. So now here we have y squared 5y equals to 0. Okay? That's just the way we do. Once we know that one side has been 0 and everyone is on the other side, now we're going to factor. Now what are we going to do? Well, we're going to set y plus 5 equals to 0, negative 5. We're going to set y equals to 0, so two answers, okay? Let me now do number 2, okay? So again, I would like to set one side equal to 0, and you always want to make this one positive, meaning x squared has to be always positive, not has to be, but better to have positive. So 14x has got to move to the other side. And you know that's got to be in the middle. You set it up as trinomial, of course, in exponential order, in descending order, as far as the exponent number is concerned. And then we go, first of all, 1 times negative 5 is negative 5. 3x times x over 3x squared. From this point, all we have to do is what? Make sure this is the right setting by cross multiply. And then the sum of their cross product better be the negative 14x. Yes, it is. So here we got 3x plus 1, x minus 5. You know this is going to be 5. Here I want to be careful. 3x plus 1 equals to 0. And then you solve for x, which is x has got to be, okay? As long as you factor, after you factoring, as long as you set each parenthesis equal to 0, you got no problem, right? Solving. I'm going to show you number 4 here. Now, as you could see, I mentioned it earlier, that square, that term better be positive, not negative. Well, not necessarily, I mean, it has to be, but it's always easier to have positive than negative. So therefore, instead of swinging negative w, negative 20, I'm going to swing this to the other side. Okay, this is what I got so far. And then I'm going to do, okay, how do I break negative 20? Negative 5 and 4, and then cross product will give me negative w, so we got the factor, set each one equal to 0, oops, so here it is, okay, well I'm going to skip 1, and 5, okay? All right. Now we're going to move right into chapter 6. It's relatively simple from this point, if you know factoring, okay? I'm going to stop here and then finish up tomorrow, okay? All right.